anything like that. So let people come on in.
Where's your first trip, Maggie?
My first trip, because I canceled going to AWP, I just recorded that panel instead. I had like a mild freak out when I tried to imagine being in the book fair in the hotel bar. My first trip is to a college in West Virginia, and I get to drive.
Okay, so that's good.
I volunteered to drive. I was like, it's 3 hours and I'll just do it in one day. So I'm just going to go up in the morning and come back in the evening. And that way I can listen to music and I know I'm in my pod. Yeah. And then Arkansas, which I feel like is going to be a whole other thing. Cause I do have to get on a plane and it's Arkansas. So we'll see.
Yeah.
What about you? Where are you off to next?
Next week, University of Michigan.
Will you see Linda? You'll see Linda Gregerson.
Yeah.
I'll see her in a couple weeks. She's coming here to launch her her next book. So she's reading at the
bookstore. She read a couple poems from that. It's so good.
I can't wait. I'm gonna walk up and make her eat with me.
Yeah, he's amazing. And then I am going to AWP. I'm trying to do it very sort of contained and quietly, but I don't know. I'm going.
You know, I waffled. I did. Saeed Jones and I were texting back and forth, like, are we going to do this? Because we had a panel together. Are we doing this? And then we just decided at the same time, we're not doing this.
Right.
And everyone was like kind enough to pre-record with us. So I will be really missing my family reunion for like the third year in a row and hoping that maybe next year is the year. I keep saying that maybe next year is the year and we'll see.
All right, we got some people join us and we might be having people come dip in and out because class schedules interfere sometimes, but I just want to thank everybody for coming to our fourth event of our reading series this semester. And today we'll be hosting two amazing poets, Maggie Smith and Ada Limón, who are joining us and will be sharing their work. I see a lot of familiar faces in the crowd, which is cool. But if you haven't joined us before, just a quick rundown of what we'll be doing over the course of the hour is I'll be doing like a brief introduction and we'll probably have a small conversation before they each read from their work for a few minutes, but and we'll have maybe more formal Q&A at the end, but we also have a chat and anytime during the reading, if you want to drop something in there, whether it be a response, a request, a question, the more robust the chat is, the more interactive this can be, and we can kind of interrupt certain schedules in order to put you guys as a priority. If you're shy, we also have a Q&A Dropbox, so you can put your question in there, and then nobody can read it except for us, and we'll make sure to get to those as best we can as well. All right, but today we have Maggie Smith, who is the author of Good Bones, The Well Speaks of Its Own Poison, The Lamp of the Body, and the national bestseller Keep Moving, Notes on Loss, Creativity, and Change, as well as her latest collection of poems, Goldenrod. Smith's poems and essays are widely published and anthologized, appearing in Best American Poetry in the New York Times, The New Yorker, The Paris Review, Ploughshares, Washington Post, and The Guardian, and elsewhere. 2016, her poem, Good Bones, went viral internationally and has been translated into nearly a dozen languages. And Public Radio International called it the official poem of 2016. Ada Limón is the author of 6 books of poetry, including The Carrying, which won the National Book Critics Circle Award for Poetry. Her book, Bright Dead Things, was nominated for the National Book Award, the National Book Critics Circle Award, and the Kingsley Tufts Poetry Award. Her work has been supported most recently by the Guggenheim Fellowship. She grew up in Sonoma, California, and lives in Lexington, Kentucky, where she writes, teaches remotely, and hosts the critically acclaimed poetry podcast, The Slowdown. Her new book of poetry, The Hurting Kind, is forthcoming from Milkweed Editions in May, which Maggie is showing to us, which is excellent. So speaking of books, just a quick promo, and I'll mention this again at the end, is that speaking to the generosity of our poets today, they've foregone any kind of payment in lieu of book sales. In other words, they buy our book instead. And so we have, as DMAC, purchased many, many copies of each of their books. So if you are interested in having a copy for free on the house, just go ahead and email me, and I'm going to put my email into the chat in a minute, and we would be happy to hold one for you. As Ada mentioned, as I introduced Ada, her book won't be coming until May, but we will have it on hand, and so just email me anyway. We could put it on hold for you, and you could pick it up this summer. Okay, I just want to thank you guys both for coming, and I appreciate you spending time with us for the next hour.
Yeah, what a pleasure.
Oh, thanks.
I love it.
I'll start off with a quick question, looking at both of your most recent books. And I was looking at Goldenrod, which is Maggie's latest work. And you begin with poems that speak to nature, and how the speaker is like, misnaming or doesn't know the name of certain birds. And there's even a moment in the title poem, Goldenrod, in which the speaker literally says, I don't care what you are called, Goldenrod, or whatever you're born as, you don't know your own name. And then Ada's book, The Carrying, which was her latest one that came out last year, you begin literally with a poem called A Name, and in which Eve is naming the animals, and it ends with, I wonder if she ever wanted them to speak back, the animals, look into their wide, wonderful eyes and whispered, name me. And so I found it interesting that you both begin with this concept of naming nature. And I was kind of curious about how, and you both began the book that way. I'm kind of curious about what you were thinking or what your plan was by coming up with that concept to start things off. Maggie, do you want to maybe begin thinking about how you started off the Goldenrod?
I'm thinking right now about how name me is, those are the last two words of Goldenrod, the poem too. I would let you name me. And how, like, weirdly, I never realized that connection until just now, the way those poems are sort of like in secret conversation. And I love that. I think there are a lot of poems in Goldenrod that are about the power of language, but also the inadequacies of language, because it's a human construction. And I feel often, I find myself saying things like, I don't have the words, and then feeling a little bad about that because it's my business to have the words. And so there's always this, at least for me, this sort of like push and pull, or this weird tension and tug of seeing something or experiencing something or witnessing something or thinking about something and needing to crystallize it or encapsulate it or distill it somehow into language, because that's what I do and that's how I understand the world, but always falling just short, or sometimes way short of what I'm attempting to describe or understand via language.
Right. So, I mean, that probably comes from just being a poet or artist. You always have a vision for what you want the poem to be. And then when it's finished, it never quite lives up maybe to like the vision, no matter how good it is. It doesn't always live up to your expectation of what you thought it was going to be.
Well, ain't that the truth? Although I will say, I usually don't have any idea about what the poem is going to be, or else I would be constantly disappointed. Like, I have ideas of what I want my hair to do on a given day, and it usually doesn't do that thing. But usually with poems, I just come to it and I'm sort of puzzling it out on the page, and it surprises me what it decides to say or do. It's more like raising kids than anything else. It's like, oh, that's in you. Oh, you said that. Oh, you did that. And you're sort of me, but not in a way. I don't know.
Yeah. Absolutely. Ada, do you have thoughts on this idea?
Yeah, I really echo everything that Maggie said as well. And I see it reflected in her work. And I think it's one of the reasons our work really talks to each other. But I think also there's, for me, a sort of a sense that there is a sort of tenderness and connection and deep looking that happens when you figure out the name of something, right? You go, oh, wow. Oh, it's named that? Like, what? Or I remember, I think house finches are some of my favorite birds, and I'm very disappointed in their names. You know, they're just so beautiful. And it's like a house finch, like house dress, housewife, like, come on, you're not a house finch. Like, you're beautiful. You've got so much about you. So I think that there's a certain level in which I love that sort of knowing and that, like, how that kind of allows for a deeper lens and a deeper looking and a deeper connection and attachment to the world. But I'm also sort of suspicious of naming, because whose language, right? Whose language are we using? Are we using English? Are we, using the language of the colonizer? The bird doesn't know what we're using. You know, the bird doesn't know its name. The house finch is probably like, superior, superior ruby crowned king, I don't know. And I feel like there's a certain amount of that where I also feel they talk about, standing in the woods, and sometimes it's good to know that's a Western hemlock, that's a redwood, right? And sometimes it's just going, standing in the woods and recognizing awe and wonder and letting go of language. So I think, just as Maggie had said, it is the toggle between the two. It's that idea of, yes, I think it's important to name things, but also be aware of the limitations of language, the languages that we're using, and then also making sure that we're not using language to limit our experience and to maybe not give in to that wonder and awe that is so important when we're experiencing nature.
So I was thinking about nature as well, and how you both begin and often throughout your work is referencing nature. And I guess I'm wondering, speaking of naming things, labeling things, like, would you consider yourselves like nature poets? And what's how do you see nature, like the natural world, fitting into your work throughout each of the poems, really? Ada, do you want to kind of speak to that idea?
Hell yeah. I would love to be a nature poet. I'm all in. Yeah. That sounds amazing. I mean, I don't really, I'm sort of against sort of labeling of any kind, like narrative, lyric, like I like to do both. But I do feel like, if there's anything that I'm 100% behind and 100% is nature. And I think a part of the heart of my work is that not just recognizing the importance and ongoingness of nature, but also that we are also human animals, and that we are animals and nature too. And that interconnectedness is incredibly important to my work. And I think my life, which are, they're together. So, yeah. So I think, I would be happy with that label.
What do you think, Maggie?
I agree. I mean, I feel like my last book looks like a field journal or something. I think I have an issue with the idea of nature as being something outside of or apart from us. And I get the sense from Ada's work that she's sort of in my camp there, that somehow we think of like nature poems as being sort of like the pastoral, like these bucolic poems that are like lifting up this sort of idealized landscape that we don't live in, when like we're just in it. Like I don't really see, I think that's maybe why birds show up and trees show up in so many of my poems. It's the wilderness. Somebody at a Q&A once asked, what's with all the birds? Which was like the best, that should be an epigraph to something. What's with all the birds? And when I thought about it, I thought, well, it's like the one sort of wild creature that no matter where you live in the world, you see on a daily basis, mm-hmm. While the planet is healthy enough to support them. You don't have to go into nature. You just have to in my office where I'm sitting right now, all I have to do is look out the window and there are like three squirrels doing something, God knows what. and a bunch of birds and trees and, you know, weeds and all kinds of things I'm not taking care of. And writing about that is writing about nature. I don't need to go to some sort of like perfect idealized version of it. So I think I would embrace nature poet. If someone called me that, as long as they didn't mean it in a sort of weird backhanded way, I would accept it.
I love that. I think you guys do that. You guys don't go to like the nature preserve and observe nature. You just, most of your work is looking out the window or looking in the backyard and like seeing it ever present. Mm-hmm. We have an email, actually, a question from a student who is asking about this idea of, let's see here. It says, you guys have such a yin and yang and dark and light in your poems, and your poems alternate from hopeful to pessimistic. And so he was wondering about how do you make this so expansive and so beautiful? And I guess thinking about how do you balance this idea of hope and loss, which both of you are, you know, very much interested in. Maggie, you want to start us off maybe thinking about that?
This is tricky stuff. I was thinking about the Anne Sexton line the other day, I am tired of being brave. Mm-hmm. And I feel that a lot. And I think, I mean, I guess what I would say first is I don't feel obligated to have the poems balance light and dark or hope and grief. I mean, there are some poems that sort of start in sadness for me and end in sadness. And I think that's okay because poems tell the truth. And sometimes the truth is there is not sort of like a resolution or some sort of like buoyancy or lift at the end. But I think honestly, sometimes for me, just the act of writing is like the act of hope or courage or resilience. Like if I'm sort of processing something difficult personally or sort of culturally or politically, just the act of trying, mm-hmm. which I think that's what I do when I'm writing, like the act of trying to engage with it at that level, I think is hopeful. And then sharing that sort of thinking on the page, whatever that looks like, I think is a kind of communication or that I think is based in hope. Like here, this is what I'm going through. Let me share this with you. Are you in this place too? Do you see me? Do you hear me? Are you there? Mm-hmm. I think that's hopeful, even if I can't write my way to a sunrise at the end of every particular poem. I don't know if that answers the question.
It does. It reminded me a little bit of your poem that you published in Goldenrod, in which it's like during lockdown, I let my dog sleep in my bed again. Mm-hmm. And I feel like at that point, at the beginning of the poem, you're talking to your daughter and you're kind of giving her a pep talk about hope. And then the speaker closes the door and cries. So sometimes I feel like hope is sometimes like a performance. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you could fake your way through it. And fail behind closed doors sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Often. Yeah, that's real.
Ada, you want to speak to how you balance the two?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's not so much for me about, I mean, I think it's again, similar to what Maggie has said, but like, I feel like there's a certain amount of, it's not as much about the work itself, but the life itself. And I think that I need to have hope sometimes in order to live. And that's a real thing, that's survival. And so it has to be in the work in order for me to keep going. And so I think that there are times when it's not so much that I demand it of the work, but I'm looking closely enough or writing towards something. And sometimes in that writing towards it, it's a desperation to feel okay and to feel like it's gonna be okay. And even if it's just to say that to myself in the poem, you know, it's gonna be okay. And I think that allows for that balance. I mean, it's one of the things that I love so much about poetry in general is that it has the capacity to hold both of those things, to hold grief and to hold love and to hold loss and to hold hope. And, we're all sort of sick of that idea of resilience and bravery. It's like, we're like, okay, enough. But I do think there's a certain amount of just the act of living, just the sheer act of getting up in the morning. I mean, I'm always amazed that we can do that. Like truly, I'm not blowing smoke. Like the fact that we get up in the morning and like put clothes on and live our lives during these last, you know, years of turmoil, the climate crisis, the war, the pandemic. I mean, it's truly extraordinary, that act of, you know, the survival. And so I think that that's in the work because it's in me. And I think it's necessary. I don't think it's necessary for my work, but it's necessary for me. So then they grow together as a way of keeping me whole.
Maybe as a follow-up before we have you guys read to us for a little bit, there is a question in the chat thinking about politics and national issues. And Jenna asks, how does the intensity of what's going on in the world, national politics, international conflict, how does that affect your writing? And is it a fodder or is it an obstacle? Mm-hmm. And I guess I would maybe also add on, how do you, once again, find balance and thinking about the political, but also not being polemical or making it personal, maybe? Ada, do you want to maybe do a follow-up on what you're saying?
Yeah, I think for me, it's always there. I mean, I think that if you're a writer and you're paying attention to the world, it's always there. There's no way to escape it. There are times when it's been silencing. I always have said that for me, writer's block happens not because you don't have anything to say, but because there's too much to say, and that we are overwhelmed and we are experiencing too much. And that happens. But I think that the big thing for me is to not try to address everything, that I just have to trust that the world and all its brokenness and all this beauty is moving through me, and will end up someplace that feels true. So it's never, you know, there are sometimes I want to tackle something straight on, you know, and that's a different kind of poem. And there's sometimes where I want to see if I can get real small and see what opens up around me. So for me, it's really about that sort of deep listening and trust, and also acknowledging the fact that so many people before us have struggled. So many, I think of our ancestors, and I think of, you know, we always think we're in some unprecedented moment. And in some ways we are, of course, especially with the climate. But I feel like, at the same time, I do feel like I need to acknowledge that. And so a big thing for me when I'm feeling overwhelmed by the political, by the state of the world in its current chaos, is that I have to remember that giving up is the easy thing, and that I'm not allowed to do that because I have to honor my ancestors. In a way that says like, okay, you know, you went through some crazy stuff, and I am, you know, you are in my cells and you are in my blood, and I'm going to work hard to honor what I have at this time that I have now.
Absolutely. Maggie, you want to add on that?
Oh, I love that. No, I just want to let that hang in the air. I think for me, a lot of it is just about approach. Like I rarely sit down to write a poem about anything. Mm-hmm. And I think that sometimes, especially with poets who are just starting out, if you sit down to write a poem about the climate crisis or about school shootings or about, you know, the Trump administration or about anything, it probably will come out, I mean, I think the word you used was polemical. It's tricky. And I think we really don't, I don't go to poems to be told that a thing I know is bad, right? Mm-hmm. Like we know it's bad. So what else can we learn or discover inside that thing? Like, and that comes down to approach. And so for me, normally if I get at something that's sort of political, I get at it because I have a personal experience, or I see something, I hear something, I go through something personal, and I write the sort of smaller thing that then sort of gestures towards the larger thing. And sometimes I don't. Sometimes I just am like, okay, I just need to write this head on and mm-hmm. call it what it is and just sort of like exercise it mm-hmm. and let it live on the page and let it do that thing. But more often than not, I want to have my understanding of something complicated as a reader when I come to a poem. And so I want to build poems that do that, mm-hmm. which means not just saying this thing is bad or scary, mm-hmm. Which is true, but not that interesting.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. I mean, we have maybe a few follow-up questions to that, but we can get to those in a little bit. I think we'd love to hear you read from your work. Do we decide who was going to go first?
I think I am.
Okay, Ada. Yeah, okay, awesome. Why don't you start us off and maybe
that was on my little itinerary at least.
Perfect.
As long as you're okay with that, Maggie. Well, I was thinking, you know, it's International Women's Day today, which is the sort of a lovely thing to be with you all and here and with Maggie. And so I thought I would read a poem called Wonder Woman. Standing at the swell of the muddy Mississippi after the urgent care doctor had just said, well, sometimes shit happens. I fell fast and hard for New Orleans all over again. Pain pills swirled in the purse along with a spell for later. It's taken a while for me to admit I am in a raging battle with my body. A spinal column 35 degrees bent, vertigo that comes and goes like a DC Comics villain nobody can kill. Invisible pain is both a blessing and a curse. You always look so happy, said a stranger once as I shifted to my good side, grinning. But that day, alone on the riverbank, brass blaring from the steamboat Natchez, out of the corner of my eye, I saw a girl maybe half my age, dressed for no apparent reason as Wonder Woman. She strutted by in all her strength and glory, invincible, eternal, and when I stood to clap, because who wouldn't have? She bowed and posed like she knew I needed a myth, a woman by a river, indestructible. That all happened. she was, that was true. And then I thought I would read a poem for my mother because she is the woman who made me. And I think it's really a poem for mothers in general and caretakers, chosen family included. The raincoat. When the doctor suggested surgery and a brace for all my youngest years, my parents scrambled to take me to massage therapy, deep tissue work, osteopathy. And soon my crooked spine unspooled a bit. I could breathe again and move more in a body unclouded by pain. My mom would tell me to sing songs to her, the whole 45-minute drive to Middle Two Rock Road and 45 minutes back from physical therapy. She'd say that even my voice sounded unfettered by my spine afterward. So I sang and sang because I thought she liked it. I never asked her what she gave up to drive me or how her day was before this chore. Today, at her age, I was driving myself home from yet another spine appointment, singing along to some maudlin but solid song on the radio. And I saw Mom take her raincoat off and give it to her young daughter when a storm took over the afternoon. My God, I thought, my whole life, I've been under her raincoat, thinking it was somehow a marvel that I never got wet. Got to have poems for the people who look after you. It is funny how we have these moments where we think, oh yeah, you know, I've been going through this my whole life. I did this, I did that. And you think, I actually didn't do that. Someone drove me there. Someone took care of me. I think that's really important sometimes to witness. And I'll read another poem from The Carrying. And I know it's here because I wrote it and I put it in here. Okay, yeah, here it is. This is a poem for, we were talking about hope. And I wrote this on a day when I was not particularly hopeful. And then the world sort of made me feel like I had to have some kind of sense that survival was possible. Instructions on not giving up. More than the fuchsia funnels breaking out of the crab apple tree, more than the neighbor's almost obscene display of cherry limbs shoving their cotton candy colored blossoms to the slate sky of spring rains. It's the greening of the trees that really gets to me. When all the shock of white and taffy, the world's baubles and trinkets leave the pavement strewn with the confetti of aftermath, the leaves come, patient, plodding, a green skin growing over whatever winter did to us, a return to the strange idea of continuous living, despite the mess of us, the hurt, the empty. Fine then, I'll take it, the tree seems to say, a new slick leaf unfurling like a fist to an open palm. I'll take it all. That's a spring poem, and it's spring. And then I'll just read, I'm looking at the clock. I'll read three poems from The Hurting Kind. And just so you know, this is just an uncorrected proof. So I don't want people to get upset that they don't have this book yet. It's it's in the works. In fact, I just recorded the audiobook and went in for my little sort of odds and ends that they have you finish. And I'm very excited. And that should, I think it'll be released at the same time. I think this fits with International Women's Day. Can we make a mountain lion a woman? Let's say the mountain lion. I watched the video clip over and over, night vision cameras flickering her eyes, an unholy green, the way she looked the 6-foot fence up and down like it was nothing but a speed bump, then cleared the man-made border in one impressive leap, a glance over the shoulder, an annoyance, and as if you could keep me out or keep me in. I don't know what it was that made me press replay and replay. Not fear, though I'd be terrified if I was face to face with her or heard her prowling in the night. It was just that I don't think I've ever made anything look so easy. Never looked behind me and grinned or grimaced because nothing could stop me. I like the idea of it, though. Felt like a dream you could will into being. See a fence? Jump it. And I'll just read two more poems. And this is a poem that's based on a dream. Well, it's two things. I have a group of women that I've been watching dance movies all through the pandemic. Every week we watched a dance movie in order to sort of get us out of our aloneness. But it also starts with the fact that at one point I was sort of followed and stalked by a car. And so it sort of goes together. How we see each other. I forget I am a woman walking alone and wave at a maroon car, assuming it's a neighbor or a friend. The car then circles the block and goes past me 5 times. One wave, and 5 times the car circles. Strangers. It is in the early evening. The firefly is not yet out. I trick the hunting car by pretending to walk into a different house. I'm upset by this, but it is also life. So I make dinner and listen to a terrible audiobook on Latin American literature that's so dull it's Dove soap. Violence is done and history records it. Gold ruins us. Men ruins us. Then that's how the world was made, don't you know? A group of us, to tune out grief every week, are watching dance movies. 5 women watching people leap and grind. Every time I watch the films, I cry. Each week, even though we are hidden from each other by distance, I know I am the first to break into tears. Something about the body moving freely, someone lifting them, or just the body alone in movement, safe in the black expanse of stage, the body a rebellion, as defiance, as immune. Ada Solis writes to tell me she had a dream where I am in Oaxaca wearing a black dress covered with animals. In her dream, I am brushing and brushing my hair with a brush made out of animal hair. There is a large mirror and a room full of books. History comes at us through the sheen of time. I write back, was it ominous or was it hopeful? She says, the word I am thinking of is strong. I kindle the image of my body all day, the mirror, the brush, the animals, the vast space of the imagination, the solid gaze of a woman who has witnessed me as unassailable, the clarity of her vision, so clean, I feel almost free. And I'll read one more. I'll read the poem that it's about my stepmother who passed away February of 2010. And open water. It does no good to trick and weave and lose the other ghosts, to shove the buried deeper into the sandy loam, the riverine silt. Still, you come, my faithful one. The sound of a body so persistent in water, I cannot tell if it is a wave or you moving through. A month before you died, you wrote a letter to old friends saying you swam with a pod of dolphins in open water, saying goodbye. But what you told me most about was the eye, that enormous reckoning eye of an unknown fish that passed you during that last ditch defiant swim. On the shore, you described the fish as nothing you'd seen before. A blue-gray behemoth moving slowly and enduringly through its deep, fathomless North Pacific waters. That night, I heard more about that fish and that eye than anything else. I don't know why it has come to me this morning, warm rain and landlocked. I don't deserve the image, but I keep thinking how something saw you. Something was bearing witness to you out there in the ocean, where you were no one's mother and no one's wife, but you and your original skin, right before you died, you were beheld. And today, in my kitchen, with you now 10 years gone, I am so happy for you. Thank you
so much for sharing that. I put my email in the chat for people who want free books, and it was started blowing up. I had to shut down my email. So that's a good sign. Just a reminder, we are pre-ordering Ada's book. So if you want that, we'll put you on the waiting list. But the carrying is now available. So support your local bookstore and buy it today. So Maggie, would you like to share your work with us?
I can't believe I have to read now. I just want to sort of like, you know that feeling after you hear someone read poems and you just want to sort of like let that sort of like bell sound kind of like vibrate in the air, and you don't want to like throw another stone in the already rippling pond. That was so beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, I'll read some poems. And actually I have a few just marked in this book that are sort of like go-tos. And when Ada started reading, I rethought some of the go-tos. So I'm gonna read some body poems and maybe some poems that, I mean, probably all of these are poems that would be apropos for International Women's Day, as I am an international woman. This poem is also an ocean poem. This one is called Slipper. Last time I sat at the sea's open door, I was 7 months pregnant, my son bobbing inside me and the same roar of waves there. What I love about the sea is its relentless newness, the constant turning over, mornings gray-green, afternoons blue and glassy, the horizon wearing its ridiculous white ruff of clouds. I am becoming my mother here, in a skirted one-piece swimsuit, my thighs glistening scallop white and tender, spreading in the beach chair, my kids digging broken shells from the sand at my feet. My daughter gasps to find one whole, a common slipper, also called a boat shell for its shape. Something once lived there, something slick and muscular, a tongue clamped inside. Imagine if I could wear my home and call it my body. Wear my body and call it home. And of course, now just reading that, I'm realizing that I'm naming the shell in the poem. So apparently that is a thing I do. If you don't know that Ada is the host of the wonderful poetry podcast, The Slowdown, you should subscribe. And then just like Poem a Day from the Academy of American Poets, you get an extra bonus poem that comes to you. And this super extra bonus is you get to hear Ada read it. So it's like dessert. And yesterday, because the universe works this way somehow, she selected a poem from Goldenrod for the Slowdown. So I woke up yesterday and my dessert was my own poem, which was wild. And so unfortunately, you're going to have to hear it in my voice, but I got to hear it in Ada's voice yesterday and it was beautiful. This is sort of a non-nature poem and a mothering poem. And the title goes right into the first line. Not everything is a poem or has a poem inside it, but God help me if I can't find one when I empty my son's pockets before I do the wash. One acorn, two rocks, one smooth and gray, one rough and glittering flecked pink, a chunk of mulch, a wilted dandelion. The poem is there, I think, pressing itself against the grit or splinter or bitter yellow, but I question its mother softness, suspicious of flowers and laundry. I swear I've seen poems riding my boy's back as he runs around our weed patch of a lawn, letting crabgrass saw his ankles because killing it would mean killing the wild violets, his sister's namesakes. I don't dare look for poems in spring, even if all the purple and green are on clearance then. two springs ago. My son was so ill, he smelled bad sweet. And one morning he woke shitting blood, saying, "My name, my name, my name." No poem kept his body from bruising purple that would fade to green, his skin a field of flowers. No, not this poem, and not a poem at all. But he lived. It's spring again, and he lives. It's spring again, and his pockets are full of petals and stones. So they're full of lots of things, and some of them are on my desk. Most recently, part of a walnut that he shimmied open with probably a screwdriver, as 9-year-old boys might do in your driveway if left to their own devices. Mark your reference, this poem. So I'll read, during lockdown, I let the dog sleep in my bed again. Ada and I both have very beloved, small, big personality dogs with smushy faces who sort of run the house, I think. I'm just getting that sense. I revised this dog out of the poem. And so she just lives in the title now, but I feel like that's a place of honor, and that's fine. During lockdown, I let the dog sleep in my bed again. Last night, my daughter cried at bedtime of loneliness, she said. She's seen the graph, the jagged mountain we need to press into a meadow, and maybe she pictures the drive home from southern Ohio, how the green hills flatten without us doing a damn thing. No sacrifice required. I tell her the steep peak makes loneliness our work, makes an honorable task of it. But I shut myself in the bathroom and cry hard into a hand towel. I walk alone in the snow, squinting up into the big wet flakes, letting them bathe my face. I tell myself it is a kind of touch. I tell myself it will do. I'll read just two more. Let's see. Those little nature things show up in some of the poems in Goldenrod, these little treasures that my son keeps. And if I'm not careful, I'll put them through the wash. And during the sort of height of the pandemic, I can't speak about it in past tense because it's not. Like we keep saying, like during the pandemic, it's like, look around everyone. But in the very, very beginning, I carried them with me as sort of a way of thinking of them as a sort of magical thinking, like they could keep me safe. And that's what this poem came from. It's called Talisman. They look like gifts a crow might bring a human girl desperate to impress her. In the left pocket of my thrifted emerald coat, a scuffed acorn, a glassy black stone, one pink Mr. Potato Head ear. When I touch them, I can believe almost anything. Who's to say they can't keep me safe? Who's to say a bird can't court someone's daughter? But in this life, it's my son who shows his love like a creature that clever, leaving treasures for my fingers to worry against. I carry them like anything I love, until they warm in my palm, until I believe. Walking alone at night, the sky feathered blue black and slowly folding over me, I pocket my left hand and tell myself a story about my life, a story I call Talisman, a story that might end well if I tell it right. And then because it's International Women's Day, I'll read this one last. This in some ways is a sort of pre-divorce poem for me, but I think it's also just a poem about being your own best partner, traveling through this world with yourself, which we all do, whether we are partnered or not, because wherever you go, there you are. This one's called Bride. How long have I been wed to myself, calling myself darling, dressing for my own pleasure, each morning choosing perfume to turn me on. How long have I been alone in this house, but not alone, married less to the man than to the woman, silvering with the mirror? I know the kind of wife I need, and I become her, the one who will leave this earth at the same instant I do. I am my own bride, lifting the veil to see my face. Darling, I say, I have waited for you all my life. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I love how you ended that reading. That's one of my favorite poems too. And this might tie into one of the questions. We have so many, but to pick from. But I think this one is kind of related. It says, how do you write about such deep topics and emotions like divorce or infertility without sounding cliche or without getting sentimental? In other words, how do you separate the feelings from the writing and from yourself? So maybe thinking about how do you get distance enough to write about such emotional topics? Maggie, do you want to
You know, I guess I would say I take that question as a compliment because it sort of presupposes that I can write without cliche and sentimentality and keep myself and sort of make it art. Yeah. How do I craft this wallowing? the short answer that sounds a little facetious is I don't know. And the real answer to so many questions about how do you do X, or how do you know when a poem is done, or how do you know when to break a line, or how do you choose words, or how the real answer to a lot of those things is I don't know. It's very intuitive. Mm-hmm. And I just know when I feel like the poem is doing the sort of psychic and aesthetic and maybe even spiritual, if you'll let me sort of be woo-woo, work it came to do. And it stops feeling like something I've just written for myself. Mm-hmm. It starts feeling like something I wouldn't be embarrassed to show someone else. And I think generally speaking for me, metaphor is the saving thing that is always the net that will catch me and sort of keep me from becoming too self-indulgent or just sort of talking me, because if I can find a bridge, to sort of compare my experience to something else, or to compare this thing with this thing, then that's my way of sort of reaching out to the reader. Maybe you haven't been through X, but maybe you've been through Y, or maybe this feels to you similar to something you've been through. It's a way of sort of also bridging a gap to the reader. Mm-hmm. So if I can find a metaphor for the thing, I feel like that is always the place where I feel safe, like I'm on the right track with a piece of writing, regardless of how personal it is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Makes sense. Ada, do you have thoughts too?
Yeah, I agree with all of that. So well spoken. I mean, I feel like I think the biggest thing for me came early, which was that sort of to allow yourself to be amazed by it, but also allow yourself to be amazed that everybody goes through so many of these things. And I think that was a big shift for me, was lots of people lose their parents. In fact, most of us, we all will. And we all die. And that kind of recognizing that collective communal experience allowed me to know what I wanted to do had to be very specific. So that when you talk to someone who's gone through a home death, you start to talk about the very specifics of it. You start to be was she on TPN? Did you have a hospice nurse? Did you cut the catheter afterwards? These are the things. And so I felt where Maggie was saying metaphor, which I agree with, but I think for me is probably specifics. It's probably those making sure I get the details right because that felt to me that sort of honoring of that experience, so that it would veer away from a cliche or a sentimentality. I don't really care about sentimentality. I would rather not have cliche, but I don't mind sentimentality. I think it gets a bad rap. I think it's, for me, it's about that clarity of experience, that specificity, if only to remind myself truly, so that I don't, you know, wake up in 20 years and forget.
Oh God, I love that so much. This is me jumping in to say, I love that so much. And I think, you know, for students, sometimes I think we mistakenly think that by trying to write something broad, our poem will have universal appeal if we try to write it so that anybody can see anything in it. It's like a Rorschach ink blot, but really it's completely counterintuitive. And the more particular and specific you make your work, the more people will relate to it. Mm-hmm. And it's like a magic trick. And I don't know how that works, but it just does. And we have to trust it.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, totally.
This might be a good follow-up. This is from Tim, and it says, when you're writing a poem inspired by something that really happened to you, is it permissible to exaggerate, distort, let your imagination change something, or do you feel you have to be true to it in terms of like nonfiction, or is there like an ethic involved if you're writing something that's personal and autobiographical? Do you give yourself permission to like change it, the experience, or do you feel like you should be true to it in order for it to be authentic? What do you think, Ada?
It's a mix for me. There's a certain thing where I always sort of lean towards the specifics and getting make sure I get, at least for my own memory, those details right. But then I'm always bowing down to the sound. The sound is incredibly important. I compose most of my poems out loud. I mean, I write and then I read it. I mean, it's very an out loud process to me. So that physical experience with the sound will sometimes shift something in the poem and change something away from what might be true. It might have been a certain thing that just sounds better. And I'm like, no, I'm going to make it this because this sounds better. But I will say that there's a part of me that sometimes worries, because I have poems that are essentially built from memory, that I have shifted things for the sake of the poem. And I think they've turned into a better poem. But now I wonder sometimes, I'm like, wait, is that how it happened? Or have I rewritten it in a way that I can't completely pull the thread back as to what really the truth was? So it's sort of, for me, I'm always going to bow down to the poem, but I think my heart is still very interested in what it is to be a recorder of my own experience. So it's a blend.
Right. Do you have ideas about like witnessing like that, and you know how you can change it to fit the art? Maggie, did you?
I'm thinking about how interesting it is when you craft your experience into art. Does then that sort of like reflectively then shape your processing of the experience? It's like, oh, I have a poem about that, instead of like, oh, that happened. It's a really strange thing. And you know, working, I sort of toggle more and more. I toggle back and forth between poetry and nonfiction. Mm-hmm. And I don't let myself, quote unquote, lie in nonfiction, but I will let myself change things in a poem for the sake of the poem, because I feel like I'm writing, I'm at the sort of mercy of the poem. I'm writing to whatever services the poem. And so, and I say this as a teacher too, if you have a poem or a story and there are like five different people talking in the poem, like, why couldn't just one person say all those things? Mm-hmm. You don't need to clutter it with characters and then have all these names and pronouns, and we don't know which he, him later in the poem goes back. Like, it's maybe important to get the dialogue in, but does it need to be exactly how it happened? Mm-hmm. In my mind, it doesn't. It's a poem.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
So as long as the poem gets to like the truth of the experience, or does the thing that it came to do, if you have to sort of trim some things away or conflate some things or even change time, like, oh, well, those two things happened on two different days. Well, in the poem, they can happen on the same day.
Mm-hmm.
Because we get to do things in poems that we don't get to do in life. And that should be, at least yeah. there's that.
Yes. Yeah. I love that. That's so true. Because I do feel like, you know, if you've ever workshopped a poem and someone's like, no, but that really happened. And you're like, yeah, but it's not like that actually isn't serving the poem. And I'm always just like at the end of the day, like bowing down to what the poem wants. And sometimes it's not even what I want.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes I want to have this beautiful ending where things sort of sum up and it feels like my heart is happy. And I'm like, oh no, this is going to end. That's not where this is going. You know, poem doesn't want to do that.
No, the poem's like womp, womp, womp.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can end on one last question. We have so many here that are good, but this might be speaking to a more universal topic amongst writers. And it's kind of a broad question, but something we all think about is thinking of, I get really bad writer's block, find myself struggling with ideas to come up with. And I had a similar question about to you guys about, you know, how do you know when something demands a poem and mm-hmm. when something is a poem worthy and when it you think it is and it doesn't pan out. So maybe just thinking about process and generating material. Do you want to start us off, Maggie? And we'll end with Ada.
Yeah, I mean, anything is poem worthy. I guess I would start there. Like, I don't think that if something, you know, if you are watching, you know, kids play basketball on a playground, they don't even have to be your kids for you to get a poem out of that. Like, it could be the sound, it could be you remembering Twilight at that time, and it takes you back to a game you played in your own childhood. I mean, anything is poem worthy. Not everything becomes a poem. And actually that poem I read today, Not Everything is a Poem, is sort of about that. And sometimes I think I resist my own territory. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm like, really, another poem about my kids, another poem about the state of the world. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I find myself a little resistant to mm-hmm. the ideas that pop up if they feel too much like my wheelhouse or something I've done before. Mm-hmm. But really, my job isn't to censor them. My job is to like listen to when they tap on the glass and open it, like mm-hmm. open that door and let them in. And sometimes they pick up momentum and they become poems, and other times they fizzle out on my notebook page, or they live someplace for years, you know, like a line or two could live on a notebook page or in a failed draft for a long time and then suddenly find their way into an essay or into a poem later. So just because it doesn't happen now doesn't mean that piece of writing is worthless and you're never going to do anything with it. It's just maybe future you needs to have some other experience to accrue to sort of like, you know, sort of like add to that thing, that image, that metaphor, whatever it is, to build something mm-hmm. from. You just don't have all the materials yet mm-hmm. is maybe the answer.
Yeah, I like that idea. We were thinking about what you were saying, like, do I have to write another poem about my kids? But really it shows your voice and it shows your preoccupations, you know, and mm-hmm. today in my poetry class, we were writing our Ada Limón and Maggie Smith poems. We were being a cover band and we were trying to like write our own version imitation of you guys. And we were thinking about what you guys' preoccupations and stylistic ideas are. So this has like been really helpful. Ada, do you want to speak to this idea of process? And
I mean, it goes back a little bit to like what I was saying earlier about like with writer's block. I think it's because there's too much going on, not that there's not enough. And I think when people say like, I don't have anything to write about, it's actually because it's too much. And so I think that idea of starting small, like literally like writing about something on your desk and just trying to stay in that is a good way to kind of get into the idea, like get pen to page or fingers to keyboard, however you write, and sort of that let that unfold to give yourself permission to do that. I also think that we come with a lot of baggage, as just human beings and writers. And so we're bringing all of this stuff of like, who am I to write this? Who am I to do this? I've done this before. I've, you know, or someone's expecting this of me. And I know, and I think it's really important to remember that we have to grant ourselves permission to write about whatever we want to write about it. And I think that's, you know, if Milos can write about the man, you know, binding his tomatoes up, you know, during the war, I think it's really important that we remember that we can do that too, that there's a moment of, regardless of what overwhelming circumstances the world is in, we have a right to our poems and we have our right to our obsessions. And I think it's better and healthier maybe to lean into those obsessions than to try to somehow hold them at bay. Mm-hmm. So I think for me, it's a lot about giving myself permission to just to go in and fail, right? You know, just fail and see what happens. But also to remember, I guess I would just say one more thing is that if I'm struggling really to write and I'm having a hard time doing it, I do the start small thing. But the other thing is we're not quiet very often. And I mean, sort of like even visual quietness or like there's so much coming at us. And I would imagine, at least for me, I know if I sit in silence for 5 minutes, something comes. And it's usually because I've tuned everything out. I've got a podcast going on. I've got this going on. I have all these tasks. I have a list, you know? And so, you know, I would highly recommend embracing silence as a tool to find language again.
I love that. And what a wonderful way to possibly end our reading. It's been such a pleasure talking to both of you. And thank you so much for spending the hour. As one of our chat people said, it's been an hour well spent. And I absolutely agreed to end out the day with you guys. Thank you so much for sharing your work with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Maggie, it was such a pleasure to read with you. It's such a pleasure to be here, Mark.
Absolutely. This was a joy. Thank you.
Absolutely. And once again, their books are available via DMACC. And so email me and we'll get you one in your hands. And I also just wanted to put in the chat here, this is our upcoming schedule for the next 6 weeks. We have six more readings. And we'll continue after spring break. We'll have Adam Hazlett and Paul Harding will be coming to read some fiction for us. All right. Thank you guys so much for spending your time with us.
Thank you so much.
Paul.
Bye, guys.
Take care. Be safe.
Bye-bye. Bye.